You guys have done so, so, so much for me and my dog. So many people comment that he has a completely different dog, and it's because of everything I've learned through your videos. Thank you. You guys are great.
So, Riley, the cool part about that is that, first of all, thank you so much. I really appreciate you consuming the content. But this is what's important about people that consume our content. Anybody can consume content. Mm-hmm. Anybody can read a book. Mm-hmm. Anybody can, like, read about a great idea. But minimal people will actually follow through with it.
Correct.
Minimal people will follow through with it. So, Joelle, on Joelle's Patreon channel, you can literally get into incredible shape, but how many people are actually going to do it?
That takes discipline.
And it's discipline. Not motivation.
No.
Discipline.
Action.
Daily fucking discipline.
Mm-hmm. That's with everything, not just physical fitness, dog training too.
Not just dog training.
Everything in life.
Hey, we're live. How's everybody going? How's everybody doing?
Stopping by to give thanks. Continuing education for dog owners and trainers is mandatory and grateful.
Awesome. Dogs just stop doing bad shit. It's incredible. And then you get to start training your dog. Ah! Hey, everybody. How are you? Hello, Joelle.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm a little tired, but we're good.
Your chair is
weird. It is crooked because I'm always like straining my neck to look at you. So now I just turn my chair.
Thank you. Then I'll just like
so
this.
So I'm just like,
that's good.
Less straining like on the neck.
Happy Monday.
Yeah.
We just got back about 90 minutes ago. We just got back from Canton, Ohio. Had a fantastic, fantastic seminar.
It was a good one.
And we've got, it was a really good one. Great results.
The feedback, the yawns are coming.
The feedback already has been incredible. We just got one piece, like literally 5 minutes ago, we just got this, let me just read this. This is a dog that was at our seminar. She wrote us this morning about, holy shit, she was able to have the first walk ever with her dog without being stressed, and it went well. And then later in the day, like it was like 90 minutes ago or whatever, 60 minutes ago, in all caps.
Can't even read that.
Holy shit. Emma ignored the two worst dogs in the neighborhood. Dogs she tries to regularly kill. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, I'll leave you alone now because she's been telling us the progress all day.
That's awesome.
Weekend seminar. Hated the walks. Now she can go on the walks. And then tonight on the walk, dogs that she normally tries to kill, she's walked right by.
Yep.
And guess how we stopped that? Bonker.
Go figure.
Like 2 days ago. Yeah. 3 days ago.
Oh, so it's not just like a quick fix in the moment. It's not going to last.
Oh, it lasts.
I know. I'm just saying. That's what everybody
says. I know. I'm just saying though. It's like, yeah, a cotton towel. Years of hell. Years of, I hate my walks. Years of.
And I remember now that I'm like reading this, Emma and her name, I'm like, she's been reaching out to us forever.
Right.
Like, but I can't wait till this seminar.
But just couldn't put in.
I need your help. Like,
and that's the thing about like our stuff here. Our stuff, like so many people rehab their dogs, train their dogs with their free content.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. People make a lot of progress.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
But there's something to be said for going to a seminar, working hands on.
Yeah.
On whether it's timing or leash handling, or we see something that's
exactly
that's a
when I did
different.
Like her exit interview, it's exactly what she said. She's like, I've consumed the content, but like seeing it in person is like there's such a difference,
right? So, for all these folks out there that are like, oh my god, the tickets are so expensive, I'm like, to change your life, that's a deal of a lifetime,
mm-hmm.
amortized over like the life of your dog. Anyway, Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, the lovely Joelle. This is the What Would Jeff Do show. It's a 60-minute show, runs from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. This week will be a little bit funky because Joelle and I have a combination business, get the hell away from Providence trip, and we don't know what the Wi-Fi is going to be, but we're looking at some investment property because I've been buying investment property for years and Joelle's ready to now. And she's like, I want it to be on an island. And she's like, what do you know? I've got vacation time coming up and I'm going to an island. And by the way, Jeff, I've already got a house and I've already got airfare and don't you have mileage stored up, Jeff, from some of the seminars you had to cancel?
It's a forced vacation.
You know, and it's like, well, there's a bunch of bedrooms, and if you rent the car, you can stay there for free. And I'm like, just help me out, look for property. I'm like, yeah, I'll go. And
you know, I'm also scared to travel internationally alone.
That, so also, that you wouldn't.
I probably wouldn't be going alone.
Probably, if it wasn't for COVID, you probably wouldn't have.
If it wasn't for all this nonsense going on, I probably would have done it.
You would have done
but
it on
it's
your
just
own.
A little crazy yeah. right now.
And it's fine. It's fine. It's literally, you know, it's good. It's forced me to get away, which has been necessary, and it's been nonstop. So we'll put some posts up. Not probably as many. I will keep up with by end of the social. But a lot of the stuff that Joelle does with all the editing and stuff, I'm sure she'll delegate a lot to her team. But who knows? Who knows? It might be like Hawaii on steroids, though. If you remember our Hawaii trip, you know, where we was like showed a lot of like surfing and beach stuff. But we also showed a lot of food stuff, too, like eating out. And I don't think it's
going to be
like that.
Probably more on my Instagram. Yeah. It's technically my vacation.
Yeah, definitely.
You're going to be still probably working.
Yeah, but I've been planning on working like outside and stuff. Yeah.
Cool.
Anyway, so it's a Q&A show. You ask a question, Joelle will read it, and I will answer it. And we also have something called Jeff Gellman Seminars or Problem Solving Seminars. This is usually historically a problem solving show, and then we got the training center here, which is where we're doing the show from, and that's more of a, you know, usually a 6-week boarding train where we do a everything. You know, we teach all the commands. We also correct the unwanted behaviors. So if you're new to this show, you can hear me use the word punishment a lot because it's called applying a punisher. And it's been hijacked. A lot of people have hijacked to mean abuse, and it's the farthest thing from abuse. All applying a punisher is the opposite of applying a reward. And we used reward-based training, a ton of it. We do marker training, yes, or a clicker, and food. Train what we want, but we have to apply a punisher, no, and then apply said punisher to stop what we don't want. And if anybody tries to tell you differently, like some fancy schmancy way of like, you know, science this, science that, it's like, well, actually read the science because it actually does say that. But anyway, so here we go.
Gretchen, hi guys. Hey, Gretchen.
Gretchen, how are you?
Melissa said happy Monday, all.
Happy
hey,
Monday
Melissa.
To you, Melissa.
Crystal Rose, hello.
Ooh, hey, Crystal Rose, how are you?
Karen, greetings from Perth, Western Australia. Love you guys. Thanks for all the free content.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with Perth. I was supposed to do a seminar there a long time ago in Perth, and we just couldn't get enough interest, so I ended up doing it in Cairns instead. But now there's a lot of people in Perth, though, that I think would be interested, but international travel and is not going to be happening.
A little weird right
now. But we had a nice Australia, New Zealand seminar planned. That way, actually, we had a UK Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, and that all went to the shitter because of the flight restrictions because of COVID. Next.
Cassandra Cranny. Cass, sup guys?
Oh, hey, is that
Cass?
Cass,
miss you. It
oh
is.
Oh, my God. Cass, we miss you. If things don't work out in Canada, we'll smuggle you in to the country and you can work here.
And he just didn't mean to say that, though.
Next. That was your idea.
Melissa posted the link to jeffgellmanseminars.com. Irene, hi, J&J. Welcome back.
We weren't
gone for long. It was like 48 hours. We fucking hustled.
Did we miss a show, though? We
hustled.
We missed the Friday show. Yeah, we missed the Friday show. Yeah.
What a long-ass couple of days.
Man, we drove nonstop.
I am wrecked right now. You guys think that like walking and being on your feet all day is hard? No. Sitting on your ass all day.
In an RV.
Is like terrible.
We
torture.
We left this. We
it felt like a animal confined in a, like we, just oh, it's crazy.
We started driving at 5 a.m. this morning. Yeah.
Next. Lori Twinsies, how was Ohio?
Ohio was great. And ironically, the next question after that is from Eric Stambro.
Hey, Eric.
Eric Stambro. I encourage everybody to follow him. Follow Van Ass Canine. Follow all of his affiliated companies. And he is an incredible, incredible host, an incredible pet dog trainer, but also a really, really good police dog trainer. And
he also posts videos of him skipping around in his bite suit like a little girl. And it's incredibly entertaining.
He did that today.
Yes.
Right. He's his little girl, though.
Yes.
Not just any little girl. His little girl. Yes. That's important to note that. Yeah. So who's not little anymore. She's actually gone, I think. I think she went to college. Yeah, went to college. So I think that makes him an empty nester. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, we just made it back a little bit ago, Eric. Glad we made it back, too. Next.
Kathy, hi, Jeff and Joelle. Thank you for all the content you provide for those of us with dogs with issues. I watched your video with Lucy where you talked about over, under, and through. What does this entail, and how does it help an unruly pooch? Thanks.
Well, I'd say it will not help an unruly pooch at all. That's a confidence-building thing. An unruly pooch, you learn how to reward and punish. So the biggest thing is you learn how to apply a punisher. Rewarding is easy. It's you can do it wrong, but it's easy. Applying a punisher is how you stop the unruliness. Over, under, through is going over things, under things, and through things helps with confidence building. But our training program consists of probably at least 50 different protocols in order to get the full dog that we want. So as far as unruly, I would need a specific example of what you want to stop. And I will give you an exact way to stop it that will work. It does not just, I never give out advice that doesn't work. In fact, we're probably gonna do a video on this. And sometimes I give out the advice that some people might go, I'm a little bit uncomfortable with that. I don't know if I can do that. In fact, did we talk about that in the car about coming
up
with
a video? Yeah, I have a lot of notes right now.
And it's just like, but how about if that was the answer?
Yeah.
Like, you can keep searching all you want, but and try as much as you want, and people do. But if you're looking for an answer you're comfortable with, and, like, I'm not going to, like, at the seminar, I always ask permission before I do something. I will not do something that someone is not comfortable with. But if you want your dog rehabbed here, it's like, well, we know how to rehab the dog. So, next.
Gretchen, oh, my gosh, Joel, I love your glasses and bun. They compliment you so well. Thanks, Gretchen. This is, like, I haven't showered. I rolled out of bed today. Been in the car for 8 hours.
3 in the morning, I think. 4 in the morning.
And haven't stopped since I got back.
I know. So, thank you. You're on your computer, like, right away.
Getting work done.
I know.
Shayla. Hi, guys. Joelle, everyone wants to know, how was it with the bite work? It's great. Everyone's really intrigued by that
video. Are they really?
I felt like totally, like, just so uncomfortable, though, because I couldn't really move in that jacket. It was, like,
you're bulky.
I couldn't even bend my arm. So Eric's like, put your arm like, I'm like, I can't. I physically can't. Like,
and that one is not even the thickest bite suit they have.
Yeah.
We have like,
so I've only ever caught a bite in like a sleeve before. Right. So you can like move around.
Right.
That jacket. I was just like, yeah, standing there like a lump. Like, yeah.
Just and bite what's, me. What's really weird, I don't know if Eric told you this. You know how many people have worn that jacket and it's probably never been washed?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't care. Bald 82. Hello, good people.
Hey, how are you?
Dana gave us some smiley faces.
Oh, thanks, Dana.
Lindsay, question from Lewis. Can you correct a 5.5-month-old puppy for peeing in front of the door? This is excitement pee puppy, but now he's just squatting after coming inside and letting it all out.
So who's Lewis, first of all?
But I don't know. Maybe her significant other?
So first of all, if you see it happening, absolutely. But second of all, if you're outside with your dog and you're like doing stuff, say you took it outside, it went to the bathroom, then you did a bunch of stuff. Go back to the potty spot and make sure the dog goes to the bathroom next.
Brosev said, hello, J&J.
Hey, how are you, Brosev?
Michaela, for people with new dog training business, what would your top 3 marketing tips during COVID be? Social media tips or tips for being out in public and advertising?
So that's probably warrants a social... Oh my gosh, my brain is fried.
Jeff has had, let's just list it all out. You probably had 2 coffees when you woke up because that's your usual, like a double shot, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I think we had another coffee right before leaving.
Mm-hmm.
You had a small Red Bull and then a big Red Bull.
And I never drink Red Bull other than in the RV.
And then I think you had at least 1 more coffee after that.
I never drink Red Bull other than in the RV.
Like my heart would be stopped by
now. So plus I haven't slept. So an online consult is the word I was looking for. So what I would say is this. I would start embracing the concept of virtual training. I would start doing a Q&A. I would start doing a ton of how-to videos. I would start doing as much helpful stuff as you can. I would start creating things and documenting things that will help the marketplace with no obligation of anything in return. I would start putting out massive amounts of free content. I would start getting out there with a always be working a dog. Always be working a dog, whether you're getting paid for it or it's free. Always be working a dog. The way the universe will look at it is Lewis, what's his name?
No, that was Michaela.
Michaela. Michaela will say, the universe says, look, Michaela's working dogs. Let's send her dog business. That's what I would do next.
Michelle P. Hey, guys.
Hey, Michelle. Hey, Michelle. How are
you? Nicole. Chicken chasing. Act of God correction. Yes. Chickens are safely in their run, but he has suddenly decided he's going to run around the perimeter and chase them, and it's stressing them out.
Well, not only stressing them out, it would stress you out. So if I had a dog, and we do have a chicken coop, and if that dog was doing that, I would hit that on 100 for 3 seconds, and that will stop the dog. And if anybody has a problem with that, let me talk to you about the online counsel that I had with a off-grid family. They're off-grid, but they obviously had solar power, so they can do an online counsel with me. That they had 60 chickens a week ago, and now they have 3.
Wow.
And they have 1 dog, and they had 5 minutes.
Wow.
These dogs just kill and move on. They don't eat. They kill, move on. Kill,
what
move
a
on.
Waste.
Yes.
It's like, and they
generate revenue with their chickens because they sell the eggs. Next.
Lou, hey guys, snow here today. First day of spring. Brr.
Wow.
That's New Zealand.
I was going to say, yes.
Good Dogs of Dallas. Hello, Jeff. Good to see you again. It just doesn't get any better than hearing your live show.
Oh, thanks, Hap.
Scott. Dog has great recall, but runs full bore, slams into us, then sits like we are the backstop. How to correct?
What I would do is, even though your mother told you not to, spread your legs. Let the dog run through your legs. What I would do is I would get yourself a little disc, put it in front of you, and teach the dog to recall to the disc. If you want to, we don't teach this, but in competition, they recall to the front, recall to the front. And the way you can do that actually is you can, I don't know how they teach it, but what you can do is get a little stick, like take a broomstick, cut it in half, right? And if a dog runs into you, get ready and poke it in the chest. Or just get a broom, like a broom with all the bristles, and then stick your knee out too, and just like swap the dog with a broom. Next.
Dexter used to do that to us a lot. Yes. Karen, hi from Connecticut.
Oh, hey, Connecticut. How are you?
Elise, local shelter wanted a meet and greet with my dog and aggressive foster. My Ridgeback is very submissive, so I was only concerned about him being attacked and wanted someone capable of pulling foster off if something were to happen. They said they don't break up fights and will squirt with water bottle if that doesn't work, an air horn. This made me uncomfortable. What are your thoughts on their methods?
Well, I don't want to know who the shelter is, and don't tell them Jeff said so, but my thing is, I think you said something important. They don't break up dog fights.
Yeah.
Really? You're a shelter. You care and advocate for dogs. You raise money to care for these dogs. You don't break up dog fights. You use a squirt bottle. Okay. Well, that's probably an attempt to break up the dog fights. If that doesn't work, you use an air horn, which is another attempt to break up a dog fights. But most dog fights that we see, like, none of those things would work at all. The only way to break up a dog fight, a true dog fight, a real dog fight, is to choke the dog out. Please, if you want to turn that into a sound clip of that's how Jeff trains dogs, well, now you're just being foolish because people do that. So the only way to break up a true dog fight is to choke a dog out. And if anybody has a problem with that, please remember that advice. So when you're walking your dog off leash and your dog is attacked by an off leash dog and that dog does not let go of your dog, okay? Please remember this advice. Choke the dog out. You know why? When it can't breathe, it will let go of your dog. Next.
Karina, my Mal does not shut the F up when we arrive somewhere in the car. It's a combo of scream, bark from excitement. I have corrected high and low on the e-collar. He usually is on like 20 on e-collar, so super low. Also bonked, but maybe timing was off. I obviously have to get out and go to the back, then bonk.
Right, exactly. So your timing was off. So keep a slip lead on him. Go to the back. Say no. And then bonk him, and then put him back in the car. Literally drag him out of the car. you know, the remote collar, it's possible you went too high. That's where the scream came from. But there's an art to all of that. But also, whenever you've got a dog that's like, that is behaving that way, what I always like to do is ask, what's the rest of the day look like? How much structure is in the rest of the day? This is the thing. A lot of families, they let their dogs just sort of like be casual around the house, do selective listening, not listen to commands. And then all of a sudden they're in the car and they want the dog to behave perfectly. And if they don't, they want their corrections to work.
Yeah.
Well, yes, that could happen. Like fence fighting, you can stop and still have a really badly behaved dog. You know, getting it up on a counter, you can stop and still have a really badly behaved dog. But to me, I'd be like, your dog doesn't take you seriously. Your dog doesn't take you seriously. So I would say, you know, no, and then bonk. And that works usually relatively well. Next.
Karen, what was going on in the video you showed with the arm grab?
That was just Joelle doing bite work with a green. That was a green dog, very young green dog. That dog is like just starting out bite work, and that will be a police dog, and which is different than any other bite dog. Police dogs are, they go through different types of training. I'm sure there's a lot of similarities, but a police dog needs to learn how to never, ever, ever, ever let go, and also has to bite in, you know, they send them down into dark basements. They send them up metal steps onto rooftops. They send them through gunshots. They send them, they have them, when they're on the bites, dogs are thrown against refrigerators and walls and they're punched in the head. Police don't quite do that, but there's some simulation of that because they want to make sure this dog is not going to ever let go of the bites. So police dogs are on a whole nother level,
Badass.
Yes.
Riley, hi guys. Been doing driveway drills, spatial pressure in 180s. He's starting to heal beside me and occasionally follows. What's the next step? And when do I add in the verbal?
So Riley, I would get, like, there's a great photo that I'll probably post of Joelle with a dog that is pretty loud and obnoxious. Definitely pulls on the leash. Is ultra sensitive to a correction, at least with its owner.
Yeah.
Screams at everything, like overly screams at the smallest little leash pressure. It's very pushy, very snotty, thinks it can get away with anything that it wants in the world. And Joelle had that dog walking way behind her in about 3 minutes. So I would probably tell you on your spatial pressure exercise, make sure you're squaring the dog off. All right, squaring the dog off. And so it's at like a T and you're just like, or you're in like one, but imagine you're like
your wall,
your wall, your wall. And you are literally driving yourself into that dog as you're pulling back. And I want that dog to disengage, not just sort of move sideways away, literally turn the same way you're walking and walk in front of you. Like, I don't want anything to do with Riley right now.
Sid, hi guys, boss caller in. Let the act of God begin to stop this prey drive. Thanks for suggestions, Jeff. Let you know how it goes.
Good. Don't stop the prey drive. Just stop the physical action that the prey drive is creating. Next.
Holding on dog training. Oh, Ashley, you're here.
Oh, you're here.
The stars are aligned. I made a live show. Glad to see you all out doing what you love. Have fun on the vacay.
Okay. Great. I thought she was like, I finally like made the live show after making love. It's like,
I wouldn't put it past her at all.
Well, I'm
like, it's kind of difficult for Ashley.
I mean, Ashley, are you?
There's no time for that right now.
Ashley, are you shipping before or after the show? It's like, you know.
Probably not at all. She's busy as fuck.
Nah, she's got to be.
She's working like 15-hour days.
She wouldn't put up with that nonsense. All the freaking shit.
True. She's got Dave helping now.
Dave is, he's helping. He's building stuff. Not to say sex for physical labor is a trade-off, but, and not to say that like, any man deserves or woman deserves sex for like doing something, because that's bullshit. Mm. But they are a married couple, and Dave does work hard, and he would like that hardness to carry into Ashley. Next.
Vanessa. Hi guys, I'm training to take the CGC with my dog. She can do a solid down and sit stay, but she gets very vocal when a stranger holds her leash. How do I stop her whining with me not there? Thank you.
So, you know, I don't do CGC stuff, but I have no problem with other people doing it, obviously. I mean, I'm just like, anything you do to improve like your dog is I'm a big fan of. So you'd have to have this stranger correct the dog. Next.
Melissa, post the link to your Instagram page.
Oh, thank you, Melissa.
Kathy B. Hi, everyone.
Hey, Kathy B. How are you?
Karen, that's what I was talking about. Oh, the bite work.
Yes.
Kayla, took my dog to a less distracting outdoor mall per your suggestion, and she did great. Thanks so much.
Awesome. Kayla, I'm really proud of you.
Good job, thanks. Kayla. Karen said that was so intense.
It was intense, yes.
Lindsay, Lewis is a new roommate. His puppy was excited peeing on me when I first moved in. He asked if I could correct his pup, and I just never corrected because I don't leave them unattended. Thanks for the answer.
I see. So we have Lewis join the show. Next.
Mark, hi guys. About bonking, do you make sure the dog does not see you bonk him? Do you bonk small dogs, say, for their constant barking? How do you get a client to bonk their dog? I've been going through some of your videos, but this is the first time I'm on here.
So, Mark, number one, it's very, very, very important that you always say no first. You want to give your no marker before you apply any punisher. It's so important. That's why dogs are not confused. Like everybody says, the dog doesn't understand why it's being corrected. It's like you said no, or you used a no marker. So you say no and you bonk. Do you bonk a small dog? Well, if the small dog is barking and you want it to stop, then therefore you would bonk the small dog, because bonking stops bad behaviors. Unwanted barking is a bad behavior. As far as getting the client to do it, we only work with clients that are willing to follow through with our training. So that's an easy one for us. Was there a third one? Was there a third thing?
How do you get a client to bonk their dog?
Yeah, I already mentioned that. Yeah.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah. Okay, great. Awesome. Next.
Gretchen, I wish I could have come to Ohio. I would have loved to see the bite work.
Yeah. Yep.
Just follow Eric's page.
Just follow Eric's page. You'll see tons of it. Yeah.
Next. Tammy, I have a question. Were you going to say something?
The bite work was just done like, it was a small demo.
Yeah.
It was just a very small demo.
I wasn't even like, I didn't even know what I was doing. Sure, let the dog bite me.
No. But no, it was bite work. I mean, the dog was on the table.
Yeah.
It was like, it did exactly what it was supposed to do. You did exactly what you're supposed to do. Next.
Tammy, I have a question. How can you use a remote collar for recall, but need it for unwanted behavior? Or do you have to choose? My 16-month GSD is still nippy, jumpy, just an a-hole.
So you can use a remote collar. Remote collars, first of all, are not for lazy people. A remote collar is a wonderful communication device that can be used close or far. It can be used for training obedience behaviors at lower levels, holding dogs accountable for obedience behaviors at higher levels, stopping unwanted behaviors at higher levels, training recall and stopping. You can go between the two in the same day, or actually even the same session, depending on your skill set. So we have dogs that we're training on a remote collar the beginning stages of, say, down, and the dogs we work with like to bite us, and they might try to bite us, and well, then they're going to get a very firm correction, and then we're done, and then we go back to training. And remember, whenever we talk about applying a punisher, and I've done it, well, with Jeff too deep on this, it's where you don't, there's no yelling, there's no screaming, you're not mad, you're not angry, you're not pissed off, you're not doing timeouts, you're not, it's like, you just can't do that to the dog. You just can't do that, dog. You're not allowed to do that behavior. Next.
$4.99 top chat from Peter S. My husky just turned 12 weeks. Her mouthing is becoming a little too much for the wife and kids. They don't even want to pet her. By the way, new subscriber.
So thanks, Peter. So, I mean, any mouthing is too much for me. So get yourself a bonker. If you don't know what a bonker is, if you're brand new, right on my YouTube channel, which you're on now, in my search box, type in how to make a bonker. Learn how to make a bonker. You learn how to deploy a bonker. And if the dog bites, you can stop it. You can stop puppy biting in a one session. Also, though, make sure when people have children and puppies, a lot of times dogs are overly tired and people keep them out of their crates too long. A 12-week-old puppy should probably be sleeping around 18 hours a day to 20 hours a day. That's not straight, but that's like over like in little increments. So it's possible that a lot of people also are doing like rough housing with a dog. Well, a dog's going to go, oh, well, biting's part of this game. That doesn't mean you can't roughhouse with your dog, but right now I would spend more time on obedience work, and we use the dog's daily food and clicker training for all dogs, but especially for a puppy, and that's where a lot of your interaction with your dog should be.
Kathy, we are hoping to come to your seminar in Hilton Head, but until then, unruliness in our girl consists of her wanting to remain in control despite use of the e-collar as a punisher. She typically does great with basic obedience, but sometimes she snarls when we insist that she does as she has been asked to do.
Right.
Just FYI, she is a newer rescue dog who we took knowing her all of her issues, but she's a difficult case.
So just to let you know that last part, Kathy, like that's like the first session. Like this is what I do as a trainer and as a coach. And if we did an online consult, I would tell you, don't ever repeat that last part to me because it's irrelevant. Okay. It's actually irrelevant. And I'm not saying it to be disrespectful or say that like, oh my God, you used the wrong words. I'm not like the pronoun guy. Okay. This isn't Canada. We're not passing any stupid fucking laws. All right. So what I mean by that is none of that was important. The only thing that's important is what's the unwanted behavior and how do you stop it? So a lot of times though, applying a punisher, there's a very specific way to do it. And a lot of it is based on timing. But then also a lot of times people are being selective. Again, they're letting their dogs get away with certain things, but they're enforcing other things. So what I would do is you got to change the whole flavor of the relationship, especially on a new dog or on your new rehab or going, things are going to change right now. It's no different than like, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to get physically fit. It's called discipline. So you need to change every little thing. You can't be selective. You can't be like, you know, well, I'm going to, what's being selective is like, I'm still going to eat my, you know, cheeseburgers, but I'm going to have salad for dinner, but cheeseburgers for lunch. I mean, yes, you can. If you can.
You're tracking your macros.
But I think it's a lot easier just to go all in. Next.
Yeah. Lynn, is it cruel to step on the leash so a dog can't jump up at someone or their dog?
I wouldn't say that's cruel at all. It's the farthest thing from cruel. It's not going to be long-term effective because what happens when the dog's not on a leash? Instead, I would stop. It's also not a punisher. If anything, the dog will get frustrated and possibly redirect and bite you, but it's not cruel at all. That's not even be the closest thing to cruel. That's actually smart. What's cruel is not doing that and allowing the dog to jump up on someone. I think if you own a dog that you know jumps up on people and you allow people to meet that dog knowing that if there's a high statistic or a high
chance,
I was looking for a different word, but chance is fine.
Probability,
thank you, that's the word I was looking for. A high probability that the dog is going to jump. That's cruel to the human. Yeah. Like knowing that you had a biting dog. Oh, you can pet my dog. Oh, geez, I'm sorry. It bit you. Geez, it hasn't done that for like 36 hours. So, but it won't learn anything from that. So I've got a video on how to stop jumping. It works. We demoed it at the seminar. I demo it all my seminars. Next.
Bruce, what do they do? Just keep the winner? Haha. Amazing. Oh, the shelter that they don't break up dog fights.
What do? They keep the winner? They probably kill them both. Next.
Brozev, when a dog is walking good and calm, do you ever allow them to walk a short distance in front, especially when he needs to pee or poop?
No. No, we don't. I mean, this is the thing. It's sort of like, so Brozev, we do structured walks. If a dog has to pee or poop, if it stops in its tracks, and like usually they will walk behind you and stop and pee and poop. We'll stop. But we'll go like, say, 20 minutes into the walk. We'll go to the potty spot, plant our feet, go pee. Like that's your favorite spot. Like we don't allow dogs to sniff. But if your dog's off leash, I can kill what it does. But, you know, there's this thing about like allowing the dog to walk in front of you. It's not good consistency. It's not good consistency. Next.
Riley, I've introduced my dog to others on walks, but as far as play goes, he's only interacted with those of the same play style and size and age. Mm-hmm. My sister has a 3-month-old puppy and I'd like them to be able to play. He recalls off play 45-pound pit mix. Can I expect him to lower his play level? Play gently? What should I look out for?
So Riley, if any dog trainer has an answer to that question, like sure, your dog will lower its play level without like knowing that the dog can do it, like will do it, like they're lying to you. How would I know? Yes, a ton of dogs lower their play level and they acclimate their play level to the dog they're playing with. I'd worry about size and weight difference, not breed, size and weight difference. Also, I don't want anything bad to happen to a 12-week-old dog because it could imprint it for a long time, like life, and it can change the directory of the dog's life. So what I would also do is I'd be really, really careful about introducing your dogs to other dogs on walks. It might be going well. It might always go well. Unfortunately, we see the cases that don't go well. And I assure you, they can be very challenging and expensive to fix. So what I would work on is I would work on existence with the puppy first. Keep your dog on a leash and see how it goes if you're interested in doing that next.
CT Vader, hi guys. How was the seminar? Joelle, what did that bite feel like?
What did it feel like?
Honestly, I feel like I did that dog such a disservice because my arm compared to that sleeve was just not the right ratio. So he was really just biting like the sleeve. Like I barely felt pressure on my arm. It was just not.
The dog did have a nice deep bite.
He
definitely caught arm, but yes, there's so much padding in that jacket.
Yeah, and like my arms, the jacket's like massive. It's meant for like a bigger person.
Right, exactly.
So I'm just like hanging out over here and the sleeves like over here.
But still the power that dog has in the
fat, oh, yeah.
And the
you definitely got to plant yourself. Yeah. It'll rip you right off your feet.
Yes. And it's not the thrashing. We actually don't want the dogs to thrash, but it's the digging in and pulling back. And actually they want the dogs to move into the bites. The police dogs, what they want them to do is they want them actually to not back up, but actually go in. They want them to punch into the bite. They don't want, I think almost every bite dog, they don't want thrashing, no matter what the modality nice of calm. It is. That's not my, bite work is not my thing. So I might be talking like out of my ass right now, but I'm pretty sure they don't want a dog being really loud on the bite. And I'm pretty sure they don't want a dog to be thrashing around. I'm pretty sure they want a dog to be nice and calm, because with thrashing around wastes energy, mm-hmm. and being loud wastes energy. And that dog might be holding on to the bad guy or the bad girl for, you know, 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. Maybe not in sport, but like a police dog, it might be until they can get the bad guy, you know, restrained properly. So as far as the seminar is concerned, the seminar was incredible. It was breakthrough time all around. It was, massive breakthroughs. It was a really good seminar. Next.
Riley, I already read that. Sal, question. My dog is 10 months old, but he's a nervous dog. What should be the first thing I must do if I'm training him?
Well, it's not must do. Okay. I don't give ultimatums. Okay.
You must.
Okay. But what I would suggest you do is I would start out with just basic obedience and holding your dog accountable. I would also start out with lots of structure. So structure in the dog's life, lots of rules, consequences for unwanted behavior, and then cut down a little bit on affection. Obviously, you're going to exercise your dog. Obviously, you're going to play with your dog. Obviously, you're going to feed your dog a proper diet. Okay, most kibble sucks, so I'd look into some like a raw diet possibly if you're interested. That's what you want to start next.
CT Vader, by the way, the latest What Would Jeff Do Goes Deep was great.
Oh, thank you so much.
Rhonda. Hey, you all, a dog's e-collar. How often do you change the position? I have a pit healer around 50 pounds. She has some irritation.
I would probably go every 3 or 4 hours. And then also I would look into, they do make some nickel-free contact points. That could be it. Your dog could have an allergen to it. Also, they do make a comfort pad, and they make something with wings. So you can look into those attachments as well.
Melissa posted the link to your Patreon channel.
Thank you. Patreon. The thing about our Patreon channel is it has its own Q&A section. We do Zooms. And then also there is exclusive videos that are not seen on any other platform that we do. Next.
Kathy. Hi, guys. I haven't been on for a long time. I'm not seeing the questions. Is there something I need to do? Some Periscope.
You're on Periscope. We stream this now on Facebook and on YouTube and on Periscope. It's possible that on Periscope, you're only seeing other Periscope questions. We just might not have a lot of Periscopers on. Also, I believe you can on Periscope, if you like swipe a certain way, like you see the questions, because some people actually don't want to see questions on the Periscope because it takes up too much of the screen. Next.
Rhonda, is 5'8" a good size for a pit healer on the prong? She's a short hair, obviously. Seems so long to me.
On the contact points, 5/8 is a little bit more than half of an inch. That seems right. Yeah. Next.
Karina, the male is super structured, on place, in crate in the house. He's fine when going out on leash, no matter where we go. It's the car, and arriving somewhere means excitement. Right. We could have arrived at the dump. He'll do the same once the car stops. Ugh, he's corrected for everything that is not allowed and understands corrections. It's an excitement thing, but I can't have the shit literally happening every time we drive somewhere. It took one of my other dogs about a year to knock that shit out.
So this is the thing. I probably recommend you not going to the dump, but just like you said, the dog doesn't know. I mean, the dog would probably have a great time at the dump, actually. He probably would roll around in the fucking dump and, like, love it. Just like dogs roll around in, like, cow manure. It's like, why would you do that? And the dog's like, because it's fun.
Ugh, Bert and, always rolls in dead
yes,
smelling
and
shit.
Yes, and it's like, and so and frankly, I think I smell pretty.
Pretty much.
So, how do you stop it is, I would start, again, like I keep saying over and over and over again, what does the rest of the day look like?
She just said it's very structured.
Oh, very structured. Excellent. So what I would do is I would switch to a bonker, and a lot of it is an arousal issue. So what I would do is this. I would do a lot of your training when you're really not going anywhere. You're just pretending to go places. So you've got time to stop it. I would have your dog do a downstay, and I would hold your dog to a downstay until you literally get out of the car, open the door, and release the dog. So meaning driving there, your dog is in it down. Okay? Arriving there, your dog is in it down. Opening the door, your dog is in it down. Until you say break, dog comes out, pop it into a sit or a down. Okay, next.
Sarah Bug Art. Hey, everyone.
Hey, Sarah.
Peter, thanks, Jeff. We'll follow advice.
Thank you, Peter.
Triumph Chick, 9-month working line GSD, redirecting on handler when in drive and frustrated. Relationship issues, tips on building a better relationship with the dog.
So 9-month old, that's a great age to start being a major asshole for a dog. So what I would suggest is muzzle up the dog, get yourself a dominant dog collar and a remote collar on it. And next time it does that, you hold up the dominant dog collar a little bit and correct the dog on the remote collar. What you're doing is you're making redirecting suck. I will tell you that redirecting is a choice the dog makes in drive or not in drive. Dogs are capable of not redirecting. We have many, for instance, a dog will maybe not redirect on us, but redirect on its owner. Okay. But you'll also have couples that one person gets redirected on the other one doesn't. It's not a male female thing. We have many, you know, male male couples and female female couples. There could be a mom and daughter, you know, team who's just actually was just in here with one of the dogs.
Yep.
And it's a choice. The dog is making a choice, and the choice is this: I think I can get away with it. Teach the dog they can't get away with it. Next.
Triumph Chick also said it's not aggressive redirecting, but definitely painful nipping.
And it's aggressive redirecting.
And drive whining and barking. He is an IGP prospect, hopefully, so not trying to destroy his love of using his mouth.
Okay, so let me just clear up a little bit of a falsehood here. You can correct your dog for putting its mouth on you inappropriately, which would be all the time. It has absolutely zero to do with any sort of bite work whatsoever. Okay? Uncontrolled aggression, uncontrolled biting has got nothing to do with controlled biting. Zero. If you've got a high drive, genetically sound dog, your dog will do fine. Okay? So I took one of my dogs, Girl, I trained her anti-tug for years. If anything was ever in my hand, she would never touch it. And if something was in her mouth and I grabbed it, she would release it. I did that to make her safe around my child. So imagine one day when I said, you know what? I think I'm going to teach you how to play tug. So I took the tug toy. She saw it. She put it in her mouth and her eyes averted up to my hand. She saw my hand was on it. She actually let go and backed up. She's like, holy shit, I just bit something that was in Jeff's hand. Not bite his hand, but bite something in his hand. Imagine trying to train that dog to play tug, and it's literally has been trained to never put its mouth on anything that I want it to. And it took me about 2 days. I trained it to play tug, and now she loves tug. So you absolutely can have, you can dabble in both worlds. You don't put your mouth on these 10 things, but you can absolutely put your mouth on those things. You can actually dabble in both worlds. Next.
Mark, thanks for answering. I know about the no and how to do it without emotion. The other question was, do you have to bonk without the dog seeing you?
That's what it was.
I tried first bonking my dog because he sleeps in his bed on the floor. And after over a year, he has all of a sudden decided he wants to jump up on our bed at 3 a.m.
Fuck that.
It was dark, but I could see his outline on the bed. I said no, as you recommend, and bonked him. He jumped off the bed, and I turned on the light, and he was sitting in the middle of, I don't know.
So first of all, have you ever thought about crating your dog? Think about that. But if you don't want to crate your dog, you absolutely can bonk your dog. You keep a bonker in your bedroom? Is that kind of some like S&M kind of thing? And what's the safe
word? Right, like you just happen to have a bonker right next to your bed.
And what's the safe word?
Just in case he jumps on the bed.
What's the safe word for like when you want the bonking to stop, you know? So only S&M people understand what that is. So what I'd like to do is you can absolutely have the dog, if the dog sees you bonk, it's fine. As long as your no marker is fine. Next.
Bro Sif the dog. Thank you very much, Jeff. Currently going outside for the walk.
Awesome. Have fun.
Sarah Buck, I'm working with Kenai on his reactivity. Walked past someone on their porch and he did great, but I cannot get him to focus on me. He watches everything but me. How to work on engagement.
So a couple of things. Do our spatial pressure exercise and do the 180, not just turning. Watch my video on the 180 move in my search box. I assure you, your dog will become situationally aware. So a lot of dogs are not aware that you're holding the leash. I personally don't want dogs looking at me when I'm walking. But I want the dog to be aware that I am their handler. I stop, you stop. I turn right, you turn right. All right? And I don't want dogs to scan. Because why? We deal with dogs that have got behavioral issues, and especially on the leash, with leash reactivity, with aggression. And I don't want dogs to scan. I want dogs to be in follow mode. So work on the spatial pressure exercise. Next.
Landon, what is the best way to introduce two dogs for the first time?
Who's that? Landon? Landon, I can't answer that question because I don't know anything about you, your skill set, either of the dogs and their skill set, because it can end up in a dog fight. And to give you advice on that, there's so many nuances that you may miss that will end up it being a massive dog fight. Next.
Riley, I don't mean I introduce him to other dogs while on walks. I mean, he goes on walks with other dogs that aren't the same play style, the puppy. But I never allowed him to jump or play with them. Would it be smarter to wait till the puppy's equal in size, same size breeds?
No, you know, or see, I mean, it all depends on you. I mean, see how the dog does just existing next to each other. I don't know the puppy. I don't know your dog. Worst case scenario is the puppy gets killed. And it's not because it's a pit. It's because it's a bigger, mature, older dog. And even though he plays rough and doesn't bite, it's a puppy, and puppies piss off dogs. So what I would say is, like, I would want to be there to see that. I would want to be there to see that. But what you can do is start getting them to exist with each other, walk with each other, do small interactions with each other, and see how that goes. Next.
Kim, hey guys from Southern Maryland. Love the glasses, Joelle. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you, Kim.
Gretchen, apparently e-collar technologies also has plastic contact points if dogs have a metal allergy.
I think that's made for their vibrating collar, though.
Yeah, vibrate.
It's made for their vibrating collar because you need metal contacts for the shock collar. Next.
Martha, I did a 2-week board and train with a woman who was amazing. Trained on e-collar and trained with you. It all seemed good for about 4 weeks. All of a sudden, the dog responds to nothing and is displaying all kinds of other behaviors never before seen, like lunging and barking at trucks. I don't know what happened, and I don't know what to do. Please help.
So as far as someone training with us, they probably did either an internship or they did a weekend seminar, because like we don't train, you know, it's important that I just clarify that, like, there's nobody else that represents us but my employees. So sometimes people go to a weekend seminar and they're like, oh yeah, I went to a seminar with Jeff Gellman. It's like, okay, but it takes you years to become a good dog trainer. But all I know is this is 2 week board and train. It's possible that this person did not see, and they might be a fantastic trainer. Just let's also put that out there that this they could be a very, very, very good trainer. But I like to always throw that out there because a lot of people, like, there's like 25 people, if you like look up employees of Sally Canine Training that are on Facebook that supposedly work here that we've never even seen or heard of before. Yeah. So, and also we've had like, oh gosh, 4,000 people that have been to my seminars over the years. So what I would do is I call up the person that trained the dog. It sounds like she did a good job at the beginning. So chances are she can do a good job troubleshooting this. Your dog also is probably possibly matured. Also, thrown into your court, you might not have kept up with the training. And this is not me blaming you. It's just human nature. Mm. Next.
Pulsar dog training. What do you do with dogs when they won't move away when you say break?
Leash and leash pressure and food reward. Next.
Kim, how many sessions a day do you work with dogs in the board and train program, and how long are the sessions? I know this is fluid, but can you give an estimated amount of time?
Yeah, I mean, I think depends. I mean, this is going to be so different than, Kim, what you're going to want to do, but it could be anywhere from like 6 sessions of 15 minutes to 2 sessions of 45 minutes to 10 sessions of 5 minutes. But it's like, what's the dog? What's the dog's issue? What's the dog's behavior? What are we working on that day? Are we doing behavior mod that day? Are we doing obedience that day? Is it a Monday when there's only a couple of trainers here? Is it a Tuesday through a Friday when there's like, you know, 4 trainers here? Is it a Saturday when there's 3 trainers here? Like, you know, it all depends on the day. It all depends on the day. Next.
Kathy B, my oldest border collie is the king of rolling in dead shit. Ugh, it shows on his white rough.
Oh, especially. My God. And it's a white dog. Ugh.
Yuck. Uh-oh. I got bumped. Kathy B, already read that. Rhonda, thank you. Just love you all. No BS, plain and straight. Just what we all need.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I think it was funny. We were listening to Andy Frisella's podcast today, and I'm like, yeah, I see the attraction. I mean, I'm a big fan of Andy Frisella, by the way. I just know it was a new podcast that he's actually not new, though. He's been doing it since 2019. But it's a newer one that he's done. He has one that he's been doing for longer. And I was like, you know, I read all of his stuff and I read all of his posts. I've only heard a couple of his podcasts. He's not on my podcast schedule. I have a podcast schedule that I listen to. And I'm like, yeah, he tells it like it is.
He sure does.
And doesn't give shit if people like it or not. And I think that's what it's like. Yeah, that's probably what people like about ours. It's like, you might not like what I have to say, but it's like, it's the truth. Next.
Pedro, lots of other dogs here at my apartment complex. Meeting on leash, good idea or bad? Personally, I try and limit meeting on leash.
So, number one, Pedro, I did vote for you. Number two, what?
Nothing. I can't smile?
You can. I thought you were
smiling's
shaking.
My favorite.
I thought you were shaking your head at me. Like,
I didn't do anything.
Okay. Number two, I could go far with this. It's like, you know, what's in your pockets, but I'll leave that alone. But number two, I'm not a big fan of on leash readings. Why? Well, millions of dogs a year probably do it successfully, but we get the ones that don't, and it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
And it's real bad. Next.
Susan, well, lucky me. I just finished 9 pages of my Native American education research essay, and here you are, live. Hello, Joelle. Much respect, muscle girl who should try out for Titan Games.
Is that your? Would that be your thing? Titan Games is the Rock's thing.
I would want to go on like American Ninja Warrior type thing.
Yeah,
I would like to do that. Yeah,
instead of Titan Games.
I think so.
I can see
because like.
Okay, I can see definitely if you had American Ninja Warrior training, like to do a lot of that stuff, you're doing very, very well in it.
Yeah.
I can see doing very
I
well.
I just can't do stuff that involves like running. Like everyone always wants me to do tough mutters with them. I'm like, dude, I don't run.
That's not your thing.
Distance running is not my thing.
It's not your thing. But I think
agility stuff, that's my thing.
But I think going from like this station to station in Ninja Warriors, absolutely would be, do your thing. My concern would be some of that shit that you fall off of and you getting injured.
No, they have stuff below you. It's always water or something.
Yeah, but sometimes you like hit like something hard.
And, well, that's all part of the game.
But you get injured so much, and I don't want to see you injured anymore.
I'm always injured. I'm an active person.
Yes. It's like,
what happens? I don't sit under a rock all day. Michelle said the safe word is pineapples.
Excellent.
Susan, with a cat, all you need is a water bottle. Although, to be honest, my first reaction when I'm bitten in the middle of the night for food is to smack him on top of his head or smack his butt.
Good.
Have you ever tried teaching puppies by spraying them with water? Doesn't work, huh?
Well, I wouldn't. You don't teach them by spraying them with water. You would correct them for unwanted behavior with water. And yes, it does work, but depends on what you're correcting them for. But also, some puppies like it. But I wouldn't teach any. So the spray bottle is a correction tool. It's not a obedience training tool. Next.
Melissa posted the link to my Patreon channel. Thank you, Melissa.
Everyone should join her Patreon channel because it's fantastic.
Mark, no, I made a bonker after a few days of him jumping on the bed in the middle of the night. Thanks for the laugh anyway and for all your great work.
Okay, thank you.
It's like, you know what? Just in case someone breaks into my house tonight, I got to have this bonker next to my bed.
Mark, I think that's just like...
Burglar comes in. No. Bonk.
Mark, if that's a story you want to tell, you keep telling it. I'm
doing some freaky shit with a bonker.
Like, it's like, if that's a story you want to tell, all I know is this. I'd rather take, you know.
It's just a towel.
I know.
It's not going to hurt.
I'd rather do like, I like the leather paddle that's like leather on one side and fur on the other side, you know. That's my preferred, you know, bedtime bonk thing. Next.
Let's see. Guest said, hi, I need to train a Chiweenie.
Okay.
Chiweenie.
So what you would do is I would start consuming massive amounts of our content. And on our Patreon page, it's got the do-it-yourself how-to stuff. But we have our YouTube, between YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, there's over 5,000 videos and 30,000 pieces of content. Plus, we've got the Q&A show. So what do you want it to train it to do, though? Like, but you watch all that content, you can fully off-leash train your dog. Next.
Patty, would a private Zoom appointment be enough time to address the proper protocol for desensitizing my dog to having the ears cleaned?
Well, it wouldn't be a Zoom. It would be a StreamYard. But as far as getting his ears cleaned, yeah, a half hour. Just do a half hour. Next.
Gretchen, I've heard it can be used on shock collars. The low stim is just at a higher level. I heard about it from someone on IG. They don't advertise it. You just have to go to the website and look
okay,
for it.
Okay, so I still am not convinced that plastic is a good conductor. I can see it working. Okay, so the plastic is good for vibrate mode? Absolutely. Because the vibrate only collars are plastic. But for the shock mode, you need a conductor. I'm pretty sure plastic does not make a good or even poor conductor. I believe it makes a no conductor. But I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's used on vibrate mode. And what it's used is it replaces, if they use it, it replaces the plastic. First of all, don't believe everything you read on Instagram, number one. But if you replace the metal with the plastic and only use it on vibrate, yes, it would work because you're using vibrate.
Riley, you guys have done so much for me and my dog. So many people comment that he has a completely different dog, and it's because of everything I've learned through your videos. Thank you. You guys are great.
So, Riley, the cool part about that is that, first of all, thank you so much. I really appreciate you consuming the content. But this is what's important about people that consume our content. Anybody can consume content.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody can read a book.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody can, like, read about a great idea. But minimal people will actually follow through with it.
Correct.
Minimal people will follow through with it. So Joelle, on Joelle's Patreon channel, you can literally get into incredible shape, but how many people are actually going to do it?
That takes discipline.
And it's discipline. Not motivation.
No.
Discipline.
Action.
Daily fucking discipline.
Mm-hmm. That's with everything, not just physical fitness, dog training too.
Not just dog training.
Everything in life.
I don't feel like doing this today, but I have to do this today. geez, Jeff, you work so much. No, I don't. I work the same amount as every other successful person out there does.
Do what needs to be done.
I just don't make excuses, and I get it done. I've been up since 4. After the show, I will be doing about an hour and a half more of work. Next.
Pulsar dog training. Do you play with your board and train dogs?
Not traditionally.
Depends on the dog. There's definitely some that we do.
Because a lot of these dogs actually are not here to be played with, mm-hmm. nor are they safe to be played with.
Yeah, it definitely
depends. Also, our job is not to play with them. Our job is to rehab them. And some of these dogs, play could actually make things worse and set them back. And they might not be ready for play.
Well, we'll use it as proofing out right. off a toy. Right. If they're a resource guarder, right. it's like, okay, you're going
to
guard it. It
depends on the dog. But when you're dealing with a dog that likes to kill other dogs or get into lots of dog fights or bite humans, you have to be really, really careful about what triggers the dog. There's a lot of, okay. When you're working with a dog that is a human biter, literally how you hold the leash and the way you apply the leash pressure. And if you hold the leash wrong and you apply pressure and, or I'm sorry, no. If you do not release pressure at the right time, you can get bit. You shouldn't get bit, but you can get bit. Next.
Melissa posts a link to sign up for virtual one-on-ones with you.
Thank you.
Michelle P said, vote for Pedro and all your dreams will come true.
Pretty much. You will get some really smooth dance moves. That's for sure. That's like.
I really thought that movie was pretty funny when it first came out. Not going to lie. Tina, you fat lard.
How about now?
I'll get some ham. No, I probably couldn't sit through it now.
Really?
Yeah.
What do you think changed? You stopped drinking?
No, I think just like my sense of humor has probably changed. And it's like, if I'm going to spend 2 hours watching a movie, it's not going to be Napoleon Dynamite.
You don't think so?
No, definitely not. Kathy B, Napoleon Dynamite, one of the worst movies ever. I guess it really just depends on like your sense of humor.
I don't know, Kathy B. I think you'd find a lot. First of all, Kathy B, how many times did you watch it? Once or twice? If you only watched it once, watch it a second
time. I think Uncle Rico was hilarious.
I think that you would find a lot of people though, Kathy B, that are going to highly disagree with you. Highly disagree with you.
Next. On that note, it's 8:01.
Is it really?
It is. Yeah, I still get a shower and like do stuff.
All right. No, well, the show's over. Whatever you got to do, I don't care what you got to do. Okay. You want to freaking just like.
It's been a long day.
You know. All right, everybody. Thank you all so much for being here. Wednesday night, we don't know because we don't know what the Wi-Fi strength is going to be down there. But I'll keep you up to date and follow us on social media. We are putting up 6 to 8 posts a day on social media platforms. Tomorrow, all my Patreon folks, I will be doing your answering all your Q&A questions tomorrow. I might not be able to do my Zoom on Patreon tomorrow because it's the day before I leave, and I'm being selfish, trying to get my RV sold, so I'm booking people all day long to come look at the RV. So I'll talk to everybody later. All right, madly in love with all of you guys.
Good night. Take care.